أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المنتجبين. صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله، صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة يا مظلوم يا غريب يا شهيد كربلاء، يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فخرج على قومه في زينته، قال الذين يريدون الحياة الدنيا يا ليت لنا مثل ما أوتي قارون إنه لذو حظ عظيم. صل على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
I second for the love of Imams Al-Hasan Wal-Hussein.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
I third for the love of Fatima Az-Zahra with your loudest voices.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
We hear the word lucky all the time. So-and-so person has luck. So-and-so person is lucky. And so-and-so person is not so lucky. So-and-so person found a good wife. He's lucky. That person found a good job. He's lucky. Another person went to Hajj or went on ziyarah. He's lucky. And others did not go to Hajj or did not go on ziyarah. They're not so lucky. We see a lot of people that they use the word lucky and luck all the time. They call this person lucky and that person not so lucky. Sometimes they speak of individuals. This specific individual is lucky. He has it all. He has a good job. He has a good wife, he has a good salary, he travels, he has a good car, he's lucky. Sometimes they speak of nations and countries. The United States of America is very lucky. Canada is very lucky. You know, in the Middle East, they say in the West, they're very lucky. They have electricity. They have safety. They have security. While people in Canada and the United States, they say the people of Iraq are very lucky because they're close to the Imams and the Ahlul Bayt. This group sees that group as lucky, and this group sees the other group as lucky. Thus, sometimes a person with luck is an individual. Sometimes it's a family. Sometimes it's a city. The people living in Najaf are very lucky to be next to Imam Ali alayhi salam. And sometimes it's a country. There are some people that define success and failure through luck and bad luck. I can't find a job. I can't find a wife. I'm not doing so well financially because I have no luck. Another person found a good job. He has a successful marriage. He has good kids. He even looks good. Why? Because he's lucky. We associate success and failure with luck and bad luck. Now, this is one. Two, there are some people that talk about things that bring bad luck. And they believe in this. They really believe in this. There are certain things that bring bad luck. A black cat. If a black cat passes in front of you, that's bad luck. If you break your mirror, that's bad luck. The number 13, that's bad luck. You know, I remember when we first came to the United States, I would see the number 13 missing in buildings, airplanes. And for some reason, I thought, you know, did these people not know how to count? From 12, they jumped to 14. And then I realized that, no, the number 13 is bad luck because of Friday the 13th. Among the Arab of the Jahiliyyah, during the days of the ignorance, black crows, a crow, a black crow, well, I think all crows are black, yeah. They brought bad luck. If they saw a crow, a black crow, that would bring bad luck. They would hear, they would, you know, wait for bad news, the news of someone's death, the news of some sort of calamity. There are some places that bring bad luck. For example, if you move to a new house, people think this. Now, is this true or not true? We'll talk about this. If you move into a new house and an accident occurs, some people think that that house is bad luck. If you buy a new car and you get in a car accident, that car brings bad luck. In fact, there are some people that believe children bring bad luck. If a child is born and there's an accident or a death in the family, that means that that child brought bad luck. So change the name of the child. Perhaps the bad luck will go away. Tonight, my dear brothers and sisters, in the minutes that we have with you, we'd like to talk about this topic. Is there such thing as luck? In Islam, do we believe in luck? Does luck actually exist? Do we really have people that are lucky and people that are not so lucky? Is this true? Or is this just merely superstition? Is this purely man-made? And there's no such thing as luck and bad luck. This is one. Two, are there actually things that bring bad luck? Like a broken mirror, like the number 13, like a crow, or like a black cat that passes in front of you. Do these things actually bring bad luck? Or is it merely superstition and things that, you know, people say, folklore, and it has absolutely no reality? This is what we'd like to examine tonight. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala.
You hear the word lucky a lot. And the word luck. This person's lucky, that person's not lucky. This person has luck, that person does not have luck. And this is in every culture. This is in every culture. In Arabic, this is called hadh. Luck is called hadh. You see people talking about hadh in Arabic poetry, in Arabic literature. In Farsi, they call it shant, comes from chance, which is luck. This person has shant, another person doesn't. And so on and so forth. Thus, this idea, the topic of luck exists in every culture. What does it mean? What does it mean to be lucky and have luck? We have to know the definition in order to decide according to Islam and the teachings of Islam, the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt, does luck exist or not? Well, first let's define what luck means. Luck, you know, when you see people talk about luck, this is what they mean. It means to receive good things without earning them. Without earning them. Something good happens to you, you get a promotion, you get a good job, but without being qualified. You get into a good university without having the good grades. You find a good wife without having the qualifications. You might have a very bad reputation, but you find a good wife. That's called luck. You get promoted. You receive a job that you didn't earn, you didn't deserve. That is called luck. Receiving something that you didn't look for, you didn't work for, you don't deserve, you don't earn. This is called luck. Someone who doesn't work at all, yet receives every month $10,000. That's luck. However, if you earned it, if you deserved it, someone who works every day, 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, and makes $10,000, is this called luck? This is not luck. This person earned it. This person worked for it. He deserved it. This is not luck. Luck, being lucky, means getting good things happen to you, and you didn't earn it. You didn't deserve it. You find a good husband, but you didn't earn it because you don't have a good reputation, or you don't have the looks, or you don't have the traits and qualities. That's called luck. So let's get things straight. Being lucky means having good things done to you, or good things come your way, success, and you didn't really deserve it. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. How does luck happen? How can a person be lucky? How can a person have good luck, have hadh, have shant? How is this possible? You see, my dear friends, my dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us a gift, a beautiful gift. And that's our brain. He gave us reason and logic. And it's meant to be used. And we human beings, alhamdulillah, we use our brains. You know, well, some of the times at least. If not all the times, but some of the times we do use our brain. We use our God-given reason and logic. We human beings, we don't take things for granted. We ask questions. Why does this happen? Why does that happen? How does this happen? How does that happen? If I were to tell you that I found an iPhone 6S in the middle of the desert, in between the sand, I found an iPhone 6S. It wasn't made by Apple. It didn't come from a company. It didn't fall from anyone. It wasn't lost. No, it was made in the desert. Do you believe that? Do you accept that? Don't you ask how, why, where, when? How did that happen? We human beings, we ask. Especially if we hear of things that are not so logical. We have to think, how are these things made? How did these things happen? Now let's ask, How is it possible for a person to be lucky? To be lucky all the time. To have good things happen to him without earning them. Not once, not twice. But, you know, all the time. How is that possible? How is luck possible? Someone to go to the best universities, to have the best job, to have the best wife, to have the best children, to have the best life, be lucky all the time. How is this possible? Well, there's two possible reasons. One reason is that luck just happens and it has nothing to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Luck has nothing to do with Allah. Luck just happens. For someone to be lucky, and Allah has no say in it. God plays no role in it. Well, this is impossible. Logically, that's impossible. Because we believe no one, nothing has authority in this life, in this world, other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا مؤثر في الوجود إلا الله. The only authority in this world is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever happens, he's either the direct cause or an indirect cause. So to say that luck has nothing to do with Allah has nothing to do with luck, that's impossible. That's impossible. How could luck not come from Allah? This is one possible reason. The second possibility is that luck is from Allah. Allah causes some people to be lucky while other people are not so lucky. Allah gives luck to some people and doesn't give luck. Gives good luck to some and gives bad luck to others. This is also not possible. Logically, rationally, this is not possible as well. Because we, followers of Ahlul Bayt, we believe that it's not, we were not created in complete predestination, nor complete free will. وَلَكِنْ أَمْرْ بَيْنَ أَمْرَيْنَ. There's half of it is predestination, half of it is free will. To believe that a person is always lucky, good thing always happened to him or her without deserving them, without earning them, that's basically believing in what? Predestination. And if bad luck is always associated with a person, or with a country, or with a family, or a tribe, that's also considered predestination. No matter how much you strive for success, you always fail. You have bad luck. Well, that's basically predestination. And we don't believe in predestination. We don't believe in complete predestination. Thus, to believe that good luck, being lucky all the time, is from Allah, that means you believe in predestination. And we don't believe in that. We believe that there's free will as well. A person has a saying in the results of his actions and where he ends up or she ends up. Success and failure, a person has a say in that. A person can decide whether he will fail or succeed. Allah has given us free will to decide, to work, to produce, to achieve. Also, to believe that good luck or bad luck comes from Allah, this also entails oppression from Allah. Allah is oppressive. He chooses one person to have good luck all the time, to be lucky all the time, and another person to be unlucky and to have bad luck all the time. This is what? This is dhulm. This is oppression. This would mean that Allah is oppressive. We don't believe in this. We believe Allah is just. Allah is adil. Allah treats everyone justly. Why would he give good luck to one person all the time and bad luck to another person all the time? That would be oppressive. That's not justice. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. These are two possible reasons for luck. either it's not from Allah, that's impossible, or it's from Allah, and that's not possible either. So where does luck come from? Where does luck come from? And you see people that are rational, they're very logical, yet they keep on talking about luck. This person's lucky. I'm not lucky. That person's lucky. This person always has luck, and I have no luck. This person might be a doctor, a physician, a lawyer, yet they talk about luck. Well, let's analyze it. Let's analyze where luck comes from. Give me a logical explanation to luck. It has no logical explanation. Furthermore, to believe in luck and that a person is always lucky is to believe that a coincidence can be repeated several times. And that's impossible. A coincidence can occur once. For example, you see your neighbor out on the street once. No, that's a coincidence. A coincidence occurs once, maximum twice. You see your neighbor twice in one day. That's a coincidence, even though we don't believe in coincidences. We believe that everything happens for a reason. You think it's a coincidence. You think that you saw your neighbor out of a coincidence. But we, in Islam, we believe that everything happens for a reason. Everything happens for a reason. There are no coincidences. But let's say we believe in coincidences. Coincidences occur once, maybe twice, but not 10 times. If you run into your neighbor 10 times in one day, he's either spying on you or you're spying on him. There's no other logical explanation. To run into your neighbor 10 times. To get in a car accident once, okay, that's a coincidence. Twice in one day, that's a coincidence. But to get into 10 car accidents in one day, that's not called coincidence. That's called being a reckless driver. Thus, how do you explain being lucky every day at several times? How? To believe that a person is lucky all the time is to believe that a coincidence can occur several times. That's impossible. A coincidence does not occur several times. If it keeps on occurring, then it's not a coincidence. There's a reason behind it. There's a reason behind it. Now, a person who got great grades, very good grades at school, could this be a coincidence? Let's say it's a coincidence. But then he got into a good university. Is that also a coincidence? And then he found a really good job. Is that also a coincidence? He's making a lot of money now. Is that another coincidence? He found a good wife. He has a good... How many times does a coincidence occur? To believe that a person is lucky, keeps on getting lucky, is to believe that a coincidence can occur many times. That's not rationally possible. That's not possible. Rationally, a coincidence cannot keep on happening. If it keeps on happening, that means it's not a coincidence. There's a reason behind it. There's a scientific reason. That is why, you know, I'm asked about the Big Bang Theory all the time. This is one of the reasons why we do not accept the Big Bang Theory. You might say, what the heck is Asay talking about? Hasn't he read science? No, we've read science. But the reason why we deny the Big Bang Theory is because the Big Bang Theory is based on what? One major coincidence. A major explosion occurred by coincidence, and by coincidence, this earth was created, and the moon, and the sun, and these beautiful mountains, and oceans, and waterfalls, and these beautiful human beings were created. And Allah created, well, of course they don't say Allah. And this human being was created with such a perfect system, with a heart, with lungs, with kidneys, with a pancreas, with eyes, all by coincidence, all major coincidences. Do you accept this? A coincidence occurs once, twice. not 20 million times. To believe in the Big Bang Theory is to believe that coincidences can be repeated many times, and that is rationally and logically not possible. And hence, to be lucky all the time is not possible, because it is to believe that a coincidence can be repeated many times. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Who are the people that talk about luck most of the time? Who are the people that say this person's lucky and that person's not lucky? The people that talk about luck, think about it for a moment. Who are the people that talk about luck most of the time? And lucky, being lucky all the time. Have you ever seen someone who's successful talk about luck? Someone who has a good job and makes good amount of money and lives a successful life. A successful CEO, a successful politician, a successful leader. Do you ever see him talk about luck and say that he's lucky? That I was lucky to be the CEO? Or I was lucky to be elected president? No. Because successful people, they feel that they earned their success. They worked hard for their success. They went through all the steps. They did all that it takes to be successful, and they earned it. They never talk about luck. Did Steve Jobs ever say that he was lucky? Or President Obama say that I'm lucky to be the president? No, these people feel that they earned it. They deserved it because they worked hard. So who are the people that talk about luck most of the time? It's the people who fail. It's the people that sense failure. And failed, they talk about luck. You know, I didn't get a college education because I wasn't so lucky. My marriage failed because I wasn't lucky. I can't have a proper family together because I have no luck. I don't have a good business because I'm not lucky. You see, luck is the best excuse for failure. Instead of admitting your faults, instead of saying I didn't get good grades, not because I'm not lucky, because I didn't study. Because on the night of my exam, I went out with my friends to the movie theater. Because instead of staying up all night reading my books, I was staying up all night talking to my friends, or listening to music, or watching TV, or wasting my time on social networks. You see? But that's too hard. It's too hard to admit that you're the reason behind your failure, so we need a scapegoat. The best and easiest scapegoat is what? Luck. I failed on the test because I had no luck. Not because I didn't study, but because I'm not lucky. I failed in my business because I wasn't lucky. You never see a person admit that he didn't work hard for his business, he didn't do enough research, he didn't ask, he didn't get enough advice from friends, from family members, from coworkers, how to run this small business or big business. He didn't do his homework. He didn't do enough research. But now that he fails, he doesn't say it's my fault. He says what? I wasn't lucky. I didn't have luck. Others were lucky, but I didn't have luck. My marriage failed. I divorced. My wife left me. Why? Because I have no luck. If I had luck, my wife wouldn't leave me. He doesn't say that I have temper issues, that I'm a selfish person, or her. She doesn't say that I'm too controlling, I'm too bossy, I have a sharp tongue, and hence my marriage didn't work out, and hence my husband left me and he married another wife. He divorced me. But instead of admitting that she wasn't a good wife, he wasn't a good husband, the best excuse is what? Luck. I wasn't lucky in my marriage. With children, I see some parents, they say, I have no luck with my children. My children are not religious. They disobey me. My children come late at night. I have absolutely no role in the lives of my children. They don't listen. They don't come with me to the Islamic Center. They don't come with me to the Husayniyah. I have absolutely no luck with my children, while my neighbor is very lucky with his children. Instead of admitting that he had no role in the life of his child because he didn't look after his child, he was too busy with his business, with his work. He never left room for his children. He never cared about the lives of his children, his son, his daughter, his teenager. What were they doing? What kind of friends do they have? What problems and obstacles did they have at school, at work, in finding a spouse, so on and so forth? Now that his son or daughter don't speak to him or her, they're not lucky with their children. She has no luck with her children. He has no luck with her children. You see, the people that talk about luck the most, being lucky or being unlucky, are those who fail. You never see someone who succeeds talk about luck. A person who works hard and succeeds, becomes a top lawyer, a top doctor, a top politician, a top CEO, will never say, "I got lucky," or "I was just lucky when I was elected, or when I became the chairman of this organization." No, they'll tell you, "I earned it. I deserved it. I worked hard. I wasn't lazy. It wasn't luck." Luck has absolutely nothing to do with it. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. You see, in Islam, in the Quran, in the Ahadith, there's no mentioning of luck. There's no mentioning of luck. That this person succeeded because of luck, and that person failed because of lack of luck. No. On the contrary, we see that in the Quran, in the Ahadith, in the seerah of the Ahl Bayt, there's something else called actions. It's all about actions. You want good grades? Work. Act. You want good grades? Study hard. Don't go out with your friends. Put your phone aside and study. Concentrate on work. You'll get good grades. Has nothing to do with luck. It has to do with work, with actions. You want a good job? Go work. Go look for it. Go get a good education. Be qualified. Have the right criteria. You'll find the good job. Has nothing to do with luck. You want a good family? You want a good marriage? You want a good spouse? Be the right person. Have the right qualities. Have the right criteria, and you'll have the right wife. You'll have the perfect family. It has nothing to do with luck. It has to do with actions. You want good children? Children that practice Islam, that wake up for salah, that pray and practice hijab? You raise them that way. Raise them to pray, to fast, to come to majalis, to wear hijab, to eat halal food. It has nothing to do with luck. It doesn't come with luck. Nothing is with luck. You want a good body, a good physique? You want big biceps, like myself? That is also earned. It has nothing to do with luck. Go to the gym, work hard, you'll end up with big biceps. You'll end up with a good physique. It's nothing about luck. It has nothing to do with luck. The Quran emphasizes on actions. وَقُلْ عَمَلُوا فَسَيَرَ اللَّهُ عَمَلَكُمْ. And say, work, do good deeds, act. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. By the time, all humans will lose except those who believe and do good. It's about actions. وَلِكُلٍ دَرَجَاتٌ مِمَّا عَمِلُوا. Each person will have his stage, have his levels due to their actions. It has nothing to do with luck. قُلْ يَا قَوْمِ عَمَلُوا عَلَى مَكَانَتِكُمْ إِنِّي عَامِلٌ. Allah tells prophets to tell their people, work, do good. Act, and we'll see who has the best results at the end of the day. It has nothing to do with luck and being lucky. Some of the presidents of the world now, you think they became presidents because of luck? So our top marajah, some of the most important people of our times today, they were just lucky, they were in the right position at the right time, or because they earned it, they worked hard, they achieved, they contributed, hence they became successful. Now, some of you might be thinking, well, this still doesn't explain to me some questions. Some people are still lucky, you might be thinking. You might say that I have a friend, we grew up together, we went to the same school, we went to the same high school, we went to the same college, we were the same age, and we even went into the same business, yet he succeeded and I failed. How do you explain that? Isn't he just being lucky? Why didn't I succeed? We have the same job, we make the same amount of money, yet he has a good wife and I have a bad wife. We go to the same Islamic center and we listen to the same Sayyid or Shaykh, we listen to the same lecture, yet my kids are not religious and his kids are religious. Isn't that luck? How do you explain that? We took the same exact route, we did the same exact thing, yet he has it good and I have it bad. She has it good and I have it bad. How do you explain that? Isn't it about luck? I wasn't lucky and he was lucky. That's the only logical explanation. No. You see, my dear friends, there's something else that I'd like to introduce to you. And you all know it. This is called tawfiq. Tawfiq. It's blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people, you don't know it. You think that you've done the same exact thing that this person's done. You grew up together, you went to the same school, you founded the same sort of business, you go to the same Islamic center, same mosque, yet that person's successful and you're not. It's called tawfiq. That person has done something in his life or her life that's earned the goodness. But just because you don't see it, it doesn't mean that that person is not blessed. Tawfiq is to be blessed by Allah. Just because you don't see it with your own eyes, doesn't mean that that person is not blessed. That person is just lucky. You think he's lucky. No, but he's earned it. He's earned his blessing. You know, I'll tell you a personal story. I know a scholar in one city, I won't mention where. He's blind. The scholar, he's a Sayyid, he's blind. He told me that so-and-so marja, Grand Ayatollah, he was my classmate when we were studying back in the day. We were classmates. And I am not surprised that he is now a Grand Ayatollah today. I told him why. He said, because he did a good deed. He did a good deed. I said, what? He said, when we were studying, I'm blind. And you know, in Hawza, there's no Braille. You know, here in the West, there's books made in Braille. You could read. Blind people could read without any assistance. In Hawza, unfortunately, we don't have books made out of Braille. Perhaps in the future, inshallah, we'll have that. He said, I needed someone to read for me. And my brothers and sisters were always busy. This scholar would sit and read to me. He would open the book and would read. He would be patient. And he would read for me for hours. He left Iraq. The scholar remained in Iraq. He said he left. He came back as a Grand Ayatollah, as a marja. I'm not surprised, because he did a good deed in his life. Allah blessed him. This is called tawfiq. I know two brothers. They grew up in the same house, under the same roof, with the same parents. They went to the same school. They did exactly the same. Yet one of them was more successful than the other. And the reason, while many people don't know, one of them was good to his parents, served his parents. Half of his income, he would give it to his parents. People didn't know this. Half of the money that he made would go to his parents. His parents were poor. He was blessed. Now he's successful. Now everyone respects him. Some people might think he's lucky. But if you really know him, you know that he's blessed because he did something good. As Sayyid Bahr al-Ulum, very well-known scholar, maybe about 300 years ago or less, in the 18th century. This scholar visited the city of Hilla in Iraq. The people of Hilla came to greet him. And everyone wanted as Sayyid Bahr al-Ulum, who was the top scholar of his time, the grand marja of his time, to stay at their house. There were scholars, there were merchants, there were rich people, there were dignitaries, there were all sorts of people. Yet the Sayyid chose to stay in the house of someone who did not even invite him to his house, who was a butcher. Owned a butcher shop. He stayed in his house. By the way, Sayyid Bahr al-Ulum, for those of you that have read about him, he had a special connection with whom? With Imam al-Mahdi, ajjalallahu ta'ala faraja. He had a special... Sometimes he would meet with the Imam. Sometimes the Imam would tell him what to do. Apparently the Imam had told him to stay at the house of this butcher. So Sayyid Bahr al-Ulum stayed at his house for 3 days. And on the third day, he wanted to leave. He wanted to go back to Najaf. The Sayyid, he came to the butcher. He said, you know what? I have to tell you something. I was ordered to stay in your house. And I thought there's something special about you. But I saw that there's nothing special about you. I thought, for example, you pray the entire night and you fast during the day. And you're very holy. There's something special about you. But it turns out that you're an ordinary person. And I was ordered, meaning by whom? By Imam al-Mahdi, to stay in your house. Why? What's special about you? The butcher, he said, Sayyid, if you hadn't asked me, I would never have told you. In fact, I wasn't planning on telling anyone. But now that you've asked me, I'll tell you. I've done one good deed in my life. One good deed. What was it? He said, I proposed to a lady and I married her. The night of our wedding, when I came to my wife, the night of my wedding, I discovered something bad about my wife. That night, I discovered that she had a bad past. I discovered that she was in a prior relationship. And when I discovered this, I wanted to leave her. I wanted to leave this marriage. But she started begging me not to expose her. She begged me not to expose her. She told me, if you expose me, and if you leave me and divorce me, my parents will kill me. They will kill me. He said, that night, I decided to keep my wife. For this reason, only to have mercy on her, so that her family will not hurt her. And I decided to not to expose her. I concealed her secret. I concealed her secret. And that was the only thing that I did. The only thing that I did was I concealed her secret. I did not expose her. Imam al-Mahdi tells us, Sayyid Bahr al-Ulum, to stay in this person's house for this one good quality. People would think this, he was what? This butcher was being lucky. The people of Hilla probably assume that this butcher is the luckiest butcher ever because the grand marja came and stayed at his house. But it's not luck. He earned it. This is called tawfiq. Prophet Isa alayhi salam, he says, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ. Allah made me blessed. I'm blessed. Wherever I go, I'm blessed. Why? Because he's lucky? No, he tells us why. وَبَرًّا بِوَالِدَتِي. I'm good to my mother, Maryam alayhi salam. Because he was good to his mother, and perhaps for other reasons, Allah makes Prophet Isa blessed. Wherever he goes, he's blessed. People might think he's lucky, but he's not lucky. He's blessed because he earned it. This is called tawfiq. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, briefly, before we conclude, I come to the second question. Are there certain things that bring bad luck? Like black cats, crows, the number 13, broken mirrors, some homes, some cars, some children. Are there things that bring bad luck? Or is this merely superstition? This is things that, you know, were passed down to us in some cultures, but are merely superstition. They're not real. You know, there's people that really believe in these things. That the number 13 brings bad luck. That a broken mirror brings bad luck. That a crow brings bad luck. During the days of Jahiliyyah, among the Arab, if they saw a black crow, this was a bad sign, a bad omen, bad luck. They were afraid that a bad thing will happen. If they were about to set on a journey, they wouldn't if they saw a black crow. If they wanted to get married, if they see a black crow, they will stop the marriage, they will stop the wedding, because that's bad luck. Is this real? Are there certain things that bring bad luck? Or is this superstition? Because until today, and that's the irony, today when people are so educated, yet there are some people that still believe in good luck and bad luck, and that there are certain things that bring bad luck. The Quran mentions bad luck. The Quran talks about certain people that believe in bad luck. But the Quran speaks about it negatively. That there are those that believe in bad luck, but the Quran condemns them. The Quran ridicules them, criticizes them. For example, some people felt that some prophets brought bad luck. For example, Musa, some people thought that he was bad luck. There are some prophets, their tribes, who do not believe in Allah, they're disbelievers, they thought that these prophets brought bad luck. فَإِذَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْحَسَنَةُ قَالُوا لَنَا هَذِهِ وَإِنْ تُصِبْهُمْ سَيِّئَةٌ يَطَّيَّرُوا بِمُوسَى وَمَنْ مَعَهُ. The people of Musa, when good things happen to them, they say yes, this is, we are the reason. But when bad things happen to them, they say it's all because of Musa. He's bad luck. قَالُوا اطَّيَّرْنَا بِكَ وَبِمَنْ مَعَكَ. The prophet Salih, his tribe, they would tell him, you are bad luck, you bring us bad luck. قَالُوا إِنَّا تَطَيَّرْنَا بِكُمْ. People would tell prophets, you bring us bad luck. Allah answers them, قَالُوا طَائِرُكُمْ مَعَكُمْ. The prophets do not bring bad luck. You are bad luck, so to speak. Of course, this is metaphoric. The Quran is basically telling them that prophets don't bring bad luck. There is no such thing as bad luck. If bad things happen to you, it's because of your actions. Remember? It's not luck, it's actions. When bad things happen to you, it's because of your actions. When good things happen to you, it's because of your actions as well. It has nothing to do with luck. Right? Now, to believe that some things can bring you bad luck, like a black cat or a crow with a number 13 or a broken mirror, or I don't know what, this goes against two things in Islam. A belief and a practice. This contradicts the idea of bad luck, that certain things bring bad luck. This contradicts an Islamic belief and an Islamic practice. The Islamic belief is that the only authority in this world is whom? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can a broken mirror have an effect on your life? Or on your marriage? Or on your journey? How can it have an effect? Or a crow? Or a black cat? Or the number 13. The only authority in this life is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا مُؤَثَّرَ فِي الْوُجُودِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. These things have no effect. There's a hadith by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi that says, اللهم صلي على محمد. He who is affected by bad luck, meaning For example, if he sees a black cat, he thinks it's bad luck, so he stops doing what he's doing. He doesn't get married. He doesn't go on a journey. He doesn't start that business. The Prophet says this is a form of shirk. This is a form of shirk. Because you think that that black cat or that crow or that broken mirror or the number 13 will have an effect on you. That's ridiculous. The only one that can have an effect on you is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is one. It contradicts an Islamic belief. And number two, it contradicts an Islamic practice. And that's tawakkul. Tawakkul ala Allah. You're about to get married. A mirror breaks. You stop? Where's the tawakkul? We are taught in Islam to tawakkul, to depend on Allah and only Allah. And not to be afraid, not to worry. Depend only on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِنْ يَنْصُرُكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ وَأَنْ يَخْذُلُكُمْ فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ If Allah supports you, then no one can harm you. And if Allah does not support you, if Allah neglects you, then no one can support you. And believers should depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Depend on Allah. Don't pay attention to things that you think will bring bad luck. There's no such thing. This is superstition. This is nonsense. Depend on Allah. قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا هُوَ مَوْلَانَا وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ This is a concurrent theme in the Quran that we should depend on Allah. We should do tawakkul. We shouldn't pay attention to these things that we think bring bad luck. قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا Say that nothing will happen to us unless it has been destined by Allah to happen to us. If it's been destined, it will happen. If not, you think that a broken mirror has an effect on you or the number 13 has an effect on you? Absolutely not. You might say, well, once... You know, it actually happened. Something brought me bad luck. You know, I saw a bad sign, and indeed something bad happened to me. A mirror was broken, and indeed that brought me bad luck. Or I saw the number 13, I traveled on, for example, Friday the 13th, and I got in an accident on that day. It happened, it's real. No, it's not real. Why? The Imam tells us, Imam Sadiq. He says that sometimes these things that you think bring bad luck, it has a psychological effect. It has a psychological effect. So if you, for example, see a broken mirror and you think it will bring you bad luck, you will translate a lot of things in a negative way. In a negative way. If in the beginning of your marriage, you think that this marriage is bad luck for some reason, you will give up on the marriage because thinking that this marriage is doomed anyway. That's why you will not make an effort. You will not make an effort to fix that marriage. And you will say, yes, that marriage was bad luck. Or so-and-so brought me bad luck. No, it wasn't bad luck. But it had a psychological effect on you. You gave up. You translated certain things to believe that that had bad luck. Rather, it didn't have bad luck. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says, "At-tayra ala ma taj'alaha. In hawantaha tahawwanat." Bad luck, it depends on how you treat it. If you don't pay attention to it, nothing will have bad luck. But if you pay attention to it, if you think about it, then yes, it will have a bad effect on you. Meaning what? It's all in the head. It's all in your mind. Will you allow it to have an effect on you? Or you don't allow it to have an effect on you? It's all in the head. It's all in the mind. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. If you are afraid of bad luck, things. If you are afraid that some things will bring you bad luck, the hadith say, then the cure is tawakkul. At-tawakkul ala Allah. Depend on Allah. in all of your deeds, in all of your actions. You're afraid of this, you're afraid of that. You're afraid that this will bring you a bad luck. You're afraid of certain dreams. They mean bad luck. No, depend on Allah.